the block.
Out called A Perfect Union of Contrary Things, and it was amazing to sit in a room and listen to an individual that I have a profound amount of respect for, an artist who is so associated with articulating unfiltered rage and anger, and who people resonate with on that level, to hear him speak with such precision and such eloquence about situational awareness, about connectivity to the earth, about the power of cultivation to lead to transformation and expansion of consciousness, to listen to him talk about planting things in the ground and watching them grow, and how that shifts a profound awareness in the individual back towards a archaic connectivity, back towards a profound inherited wisdom of the reality of the earth and of seasonality and of cultivation and of change and what that means for each of us, especially in this this new era of Trump, but even beyond that. Somebody who I believe is so misunderstood as an artist and yet speaks so profoundly to a lot of the helplessness, a lot of the rage, and a lot of the need we all feel to work together for a kind of collective transformation. It was a very inspiring evening, and he spoke of Joseph Campbell and Carl Jung and of consciousness and transformation. I mean, it really sounded like he was on the Block Radio, something we really hope to have happen here in the near future. And it was a great conversation to be a part of. And as a lead into this week's guest, we hop across the pond this week and talk to a dear friend and one of the a world-renowned expert in archaeology, anthropology, and in the field of archaeoacoustics. And I'm going to get more into Paul Devereux in a minute. But also in this episode, I've pulled the audio coming up here in a few minutes before we get to our conversation with Paul. I pulled the audio from a TED Talk given by another dear colleague and brilliant scientist, Ian McGilchrist, who wrote a wonderful book called The Master and His Emissary, The Divided Brain. And he's a neuropsychologist, and he writes about where we are in the research of the hemispheres of the brain. And I think this is profoundly important book, and I think this research has profound and lasting implications for where we are as a culture, where we are as a society, where we are as individuals, and how we need to think about moving forward together. The audio is important for several reasons. You need to check this TED Talk out, and go check out the RSA Animate version of this TED Talk for the accompanying visuals, which I think are spectacular. But if anything explains from a neuropsychologist standpoint where we are in this Kali Yuga, where we are in this period of left brain dominance, right, of the sort of Machiavellian world that we find ourselves in, this toxic masculine materialist viewpoint of the world that looks at everything in terms of ranking and separation and hierarchy and usefulness to an economic engine or one particular ego machine or another. This is all very explainable through an understanding of how we've cultivated individual and collective consciousness over the past several hundred years, from our educational systems to our business practices to the way and we write history books and what we focus on. This is why, as so many people tell us, our artists, you know, I quote Lydia Yuknovich on this show a lot, but because she's infinitely quotable, and our artists, our poets, our musicians don't just provide us entertainment. I think one of the really terrible things that's happened over the past several years is this idea that art is for entertainment purposes only. You see this in Trump's weird response to the Hamilton cast speaking openly to Vice President-elect Pence. There's this idea that if you're an artist, you don't have any right to comment or say anything deliberate and precise and focused about our culture. And I would argue that that's exactly the opposite, that our art needs to be immediate, it needs to be relevant, and if it's not speaking to the zeitgeist of the age, if it's not helping people find mechanisms to voice their own experience and their own reaction to the world they find themselves in, then it really is just infotainment or entertainment and distraction, and not anything that holds these transformative elements and a viewpoint back into our deepest collective selves. Ian McGilchrist's piece, why I've included it in this episode, one is I think it absolutely speaks to the sort of problem of the age, and maybe even offer some practical tips of how we can move out of it. But I think it has everything to do with our guest this week as well, Paul Devereux. So fascinating and such a brilliant man, and we were so happy to have him on the show. I met him, I'll read his full bio when we introduce him in the program, but I met him a couple years ago when he came to be a keynote speaker at an Anthropology of Consciousness conference that we had in the Chicago area. And Paul, I became aware of his work years ago when he wrote The Long Trip, a book about the prehistory of psychedelia. The book was instrumental in me getting into the field that I've got into after that, which is the study of Neolithic and Paleolithic religion, which led to my going into transformative studies in grad school, led to my meeting Chris Ryan and being on his show, and to writing articles about Paleolithic caves and Paleolithic religion, which has sort of been the whole reason that I'm here doing this program. And Paul's writing and his work early on were absolutely instrumental in looking at the use of psychedelic plants in shamanic activities in prehistory. So it's a wonderful book, but he's also done work on debunking the myth of ley lines. And recently, his fabulous work in anthropology and archaeology, going around to all of the sacred sites on the island and looking at bluestones, looking at the various ways that the ancients used sound to alter and expand symbolic consciousness. He's one of the leaders in this field, and it's an utterly fascinating line of work that, if you're not aware of it, you need to be, and we'll get into it in our conversation. Paul, I think, studies these things, and I asked him about this and he was a bit noncommittal, but he studies these things, I think, and we'll see what he says when we get into the conversation, for similar reasons that I do, which is that we're looking for a kind of humanity that hasn't been branded yet, if you know what I mean by that. It hasn't been encultured. We live in the confines of these disparate cultures now, and it's very difficult to think of somebody in the world without thinking of all of the labels that come along with that person, whether they be nationalistic labels, whether they be ideological, whether they have to do with that person's race, or gender or class. It's very hard to think of people as just people, and I think this recent election cycle shows some of the damage in that. It's my belief that national politics, at least, should center around the things that bring us together, not the things that keep us different and separate from one another. And I think, at least in these United States, but really around the world, we are anemic in our conversation on what binds us. And this is not, some pitch to get along with racists and bigots. This is not a kumbaya moment coming from a white cisgendered male who is not directly under attack from this new draconian administration. This is just simply a plea, and maybe not even a plea, just a mention of the fact that on the long view of human history, when we take a step back and really try to look at one another, especially when we go back 10, 20, 30,000 years ago, we don't find some golden era where there was no violence, where people got along perfectly. We don't find a utopia in our history, but we do find some ways that humans related to one another and related to the earth that weren't characterized by this kind of infernal and intense and what's the word I'm looking for? Just nonstop hostility and distrust of one another. This drowning in these labels that keep us separate and alone, and identifying only with those who act and believe and think exactly the same as we do. The social media echo chamber and all the rest. There's a great line from the Quran when Allah is speaking, and he's talking about why, through the prophet, and he's talking about why he made people into different nations. And he says, I made you into different nations so that you may know one another. Right, that by being exposed to another culture, being exposed to another group of people, being exposed to another set of rituals and practices and beliefs and customs, that we would learn something more about the complexity and the depth of the human experience. But the xenophobia, right, the list of phobias that we have now is telling us to not trust anything that isn't same. Not trust or indulge anything that isn't exactly aligned with all of our already predetermined principles and tastes and preferences and rituals. And that's a very sad and dangerous place for our society to be, because the full collective, I say this all the time, the collective wisdom of humanity, what your inheritance is, what your actual inheritance is the collective wisdom and experience of the entire human race. That belongs to everybody on this planet, but we minimize that for a thimble full of grace. We want to shrink that down to one deity or one cultural practice or one skin color or one sexual preference, and then give this preferential treatment, put this on top of the pyramid, and then try to delegitimize everything else. It's a very anemic and sort of sad way to exist. And what I love about Paul's work is that we talk a little bit about Brexit and the Trump thing, and we start with the kind of modern conversation. But what I love about the work that he's doing in this field of archaeoacoustics and of studying ancient peoples is he's looking for a more rich subtext. He's looking at a time when maybe we lived lives that were simpler in terms of geopolitically and technologically, but we're much more rich and fulfilling in terms of our connectivity, our awareness of the cosmos and our place in it. So it was a wonderful conversation, and he's a beautiful man, and I really think you're going to enjoy it. It's been such a pleasure to do this show and have the opportunity to speak with some of these people that are just leaders in the world in their fields. And I don't say that in any kind of star fucking way or anything else, but it's humbling, and it's a beautiful experience to have these conversations. To me, they are valuable. To me, they point to an aspect of our dignity and our integrity as people that goes beyond all of the stuff we're reading on social media about one another now. And to me, a guy like Paul is the very reason we started the show, which is to dialogue with people who are engaged in the process of transformation and creativity and just being utterly devoted to those aspects of our humanity that make us beautiful and valuable and authentic people. So I think you're going to enjoy the show. I sure enjoyed talking to him, folks, and let us know what you think. All right, enjoy the show. We will see you on the other side. Stone cutters made them from stones, chosen especially for you and I, who live inside. The mountaineers gathered timber piled high, in which to take a long, traveling many miles, knowing they get here. When they got here, all exhausted, on the roof leaks, they got started. And now when the rain comes, we can be thankful. Oh,
The division of the brain is something neuroscientists don't like to talk about anymore. It enjoyed a sort of popularity in the 60s and 70s after the first split brain operations, and it led to a sort of popularization which has since been proved to be entirely false. It's not true that one part of the brain does reason and the other does emotion. Both are profoundly involved in both. It's not true that language resides only in the left hemisphere. It doesn't. Important aspects are in the right. It's not true that visual imagery is only in the right hemisphere. Lots of it is in the left. And so in a sort of fit of despair, people have given up talking about it. But the problem won't really go away, because this organ, which is all about making connection, is profoundly divided. It's there inside all of us, and it's got more divided over the course of human evolution. So the ratio of the corpus callosum to the volume of the hemispheres has got smaller over evolution. And the plot thickens when you realize that one of the main, if not the main, function of the corpus callosum is in fact to inhibit. It's to inhibit the other hemisphere. So something very important is going on here about keeping things apart from one another. And not only that, the brain is profoundly asymmetric. It's broader at the back on the left and broader on the right at the front, and slightly juts forward and backward. And it's as though somebody got hold of the brain from underneath and given it a sort of sharp twist clockwise. What is all that about? If one just needed more brain space, one would do it symmetrically. The skull is symmetrical. The box in which all this is contained is symmetrical. Why go to trouble to expand some bits of one hemisphere and some bits of another, unless they were doing rather different things? What are they doing? Well, it's not just we who have these divided brains. Birds and animals have them as well. I think the simplest way to think of it is if you imagine a bird trying to feed on a seed against the background of grit or pebbles, it's got to focus very narrowly and clearly on that little seed and be able to pick it out against that background. But it's also, if it's going to stay alive, it's got to actually keep a quite different kind of attention open. It's got to be on the lookout for predators or for friends, for conspecifics, but for whatever else is going on. It seems that birds and animals quite reliably use their left hemisphere for this narrow focused attention to something it already knows is of importance to it. And they keep their right hemisphere vigilant broadly for whatever might be, without any commitment as to what that might be. And they also use their right hemispheres for making connections with the world. So they approach their mates and bond with their mates more using the right hemisphere. But then you come to the humans, and it's true that actually in humans too this kind of attention is one of the big differences. The right hemisphere gives sustained, broad, open vigilance, alertness, where the left hemisphere gives narrow, sharply focused attention to detail. And people who lose their right hemispheres have a pathological narrowing of the window of attention. But humans are different. The big thing about humans is their frontal lobes. And the purpose of that part of the brain? To inhibit the rest of the brain, to stop the immediate happening. So standing back in time and space from the immediacy of experience. And that enables us to do two things. It enables us to do what neuroscientists are always telling us we're very good at, which is outwitting the other party, being Machiavellian. And that's interesting to me, because that's absolutely right. We can read other people's minds and intentions, and if we so want to, we can deceive them. But the bit that's always curiously missed out here is that it also enables us to empathize for the first time, because there's a sort of necessary distance from the world. If you're right up against it, you just bite. But if you can stand back and see that other individual is an individual like me, who might have interests and values and feelings like mine, then you can make a bond. There's a sort of necessary distance, as there is in reading. Too close, you can't see anything. Too far, you can't read it. So the distance from the world that is provided is profoundly creative of all that is human, both the Machiavellian and the Erasmian. Now, to do the Machiavellian stuff, to manipulate the world, which is very important, we need to be able to interact with the world and use it for our benefit. Food is the starting point. but we also, with our left hemispheres, grasp using our right hand things and make tools. We also use that part of language to grasp things, as we say. It pins them down. So when we already know something's important and we want to be precise about it, we use our left hemispheres in that way. And to do that, we need a simplified version of reality. It's no good if you're fighting a campaign, having all the information on all the plant species that grow in the terrain of battle. What you need is to know the specifics of where certain things are that matter to you, and so you have a map and you have little flags. It's not reality, but it works better. The newness of the right hemisphere makes it a devil's advocate. It's always on the lookout for things that might be different from our expectations. It sees things in context. It understands implicit meaning, metaphor, body language, emotional expression in the face. It deals with an embodied world in which we stand embodied in relation to a world that is concrete. It understands individuals, not just categories. It actually has a disposition for the living rather than the mechanical. And this is so marked that even in a left-hander who is actually using their right hemisphere in daily life to manipulate tools with their left hand, it is their left hemisphere, not their right hemisphere, in which tools and machines are coded. So this is very interesting. And it changes the view of the body. The body becomes an assemblage of parts in the left hemisphere. If I had to sum it all up, I would get away from all those things that we used to say, reason and imagination. Let me make it very clear. For imagination, you need both hemispheres. Let me make it very clear. For reason, you need both hemispheres. So if I had to sum it up, I'd say the world of the left hemisphere, dependent on denotative language and abstraction, yields clarity and power to manipulate things that are known, fixed, static, isolated, decontextualized, explicit, general in nature, but ultimately lifeless. The right hemisphere, by contrast, yields a world of individual, changing, evolving, interconnected, implicit, incarnate, living beings within the context of the lived world, but in the nature of things never fully graspable, never perfectly known. And to this world, it exists in a certain relationship. The knowledge that's mediated by the left hemisphere is, however, within a closed system. It has the advantage of perfection, but the perfection is bought ultimately at the price of emptiness. There's a problem here about the nature of the two worlds. They offer us two versions of the world, and obviously we combine them in different ways all the time. We need to rely on certain things to manipulate the world, but for a broad understanding of it, we need to use knowledge that comes from the right hemisphere. And it's my suggestion to you that in the history of Western culture, things started in the 6th century BC in the Augustan era and in the 15th, 16th century in Europe with a wonderful balancing of these hemispheres. But in each case, it drifted further to the left hemisphere's point of view. Nowadays, we live in a world which is paradoxical. We pursue happiness, and it leads to resentment, and it leads to unhappiness, and it leads, in fact, to an explosion of mental illness. We've pursued freedom, but we now live in a world which is more monitored by CCTV cameras, and in which our daily lives are more subjected to what de Tocqueville called a network of small, complicated rules that cover the surface of life and strangle freedom. More information, we have it in spades, but we get less and less able to use it, to understand it, to be wise. There's a paradoxical relationship, as I know as a psychiatrist, between adversity and fulfillment, between restraint and freedom, between the knowledge of the parts and wisdom about the whole. It's the machine model again that is supposed to answer everything, but it doesn't. Think about this. Even rationality is grounded in a leap of intuition. There is no way you can rationally prove that rationality is a good way to look at the world. We intuit that it is very helpful. And this is not new. At the other end of the process, rationality we know from Gödel's theorem, we know from what Pascal was saying hundreds of years before Gödel, that the end point of rationality is to demonstrate the limits to rationality. In our modern world, we've developed something that looks awfully like the left hemisphere's world. We prioritize the virtual over the real. The technical becomes important. Bureaucracy flourishes. The picture, however, is fragmented. There's a loss of uniqueness. The how has become subsumed in what. And the need for control leads to a paranoia in society that we need to govern and control everything. Why this shift? I think there are three reasons. One is the left hemisphere's talk is very convincing because it shaved everything that it doesn't find fits with its model off and cut it out. So this particular model is entirely self-consistent, largely because it's made itself so. I also call the left hemisphere the Berlusconi of the brain, because it controls the media. It's the one with which it's very vocal on its own behalf. The right hemisphere doesn't have a voice, and it can't construct these same arguments. And I also think, rather more importantly, there's a sort of hall of mirrors effect. The more we get trapped into this, the more we undercut and ironize things that might have led us out of it, and we just get reflected back into more of what we know about what we know about what we know. And I just want to make it clear, I'm not against whatever it is the left hemisphere has to offer. Nobody could be more passionate in an age in which we neglect reason and we neglect careful use of language. Nobody could be more passionate than myself about language and about reason. It's just that I'm even more passionate about the right hemisphere and the need to return what that knows to a broader context. It turned out that Einstein's thinking somehow presaged this thing about the structure of the brain. He said, the intuitive mind is a sacred gift, and the rational mind is a faithful servant. We have created a society that honors the servant, but has forgotten the gift.
Hi, I'm Douglas Rushkoff, author of Throwing Rocks at the Google Bus, and you're listening to On the Block Radio.
Well, my name's Paul Devereux. I edited the Lay Hunter Journal for 20 years in the 1970s and 80s, and indeed to the mid-1990s. I'm currently a founding editor of a journal called Time and Mind, the Journal of Archaeology, Consciousness and Culture. And I write a lot of books and papers, some of them academic, some of them for popular readerships. And I'm a columnist for Fortune Times Journal, amongst other things.
The broad framework for this weekend, and indeed for the film we're putting together, is, as the name suggests, megalithomania, so a focus on megalithic sites the world over. Why do you think the ancients went to such trouble to build them?
Well, as I explain in my book, Sacred Geography, we started out, the human race, long, long ago, worshipping or venerating natural sites in the landscape, topographical places, mountains, caves, springs, and so forth, even trees, sacred trees. And at some point, different times, different cultures and societies, people started to, as it were, improve on nature. They started to build their own monumental sites. And this was often accompanied by bringing material from the older venerated natural sites. So, for example, Newgrange in Ireland has quartz rocks in its structure that were brought from the Wicklow Mountains, 60 miles away. Some of the burial mounds, say in Cornwall, have clays from 30 or 40 miles away brought to build up. No need, plenty of clay locally. But these things were like relics of sacred places that were brought to, if you like, give power, give significance, to give legitimacy to the new monuments that were being built. The reason for the monuments varies a lot from culture to culture and age to age. To begin with, people used rock art to embellish the natural places. It might be a rock face, it could be a cave or whatever. Sometimes they were aligned to the heavens, so, you know, rising sun, setting moon, whatever it might be. At certain times of year, they fitted in with the ritual calendar of the people who were using and building and using the monumental site. There were monuments that were built for burial, for funerary celebrations. There were monuments that were built for the gathering of the tribes. And probably quite a few built for shamans and priests or whatever to commune with the spirit world. So there's a multiple set of uses. There's no one explanation for monuments around the world.
Why do you think that in a modern context, though, that these same sites, these same edifices, are now speaking to modern people?
Because of books and internet and so on, things like this. You can go back to the history. I mean, in the 16th, 17th centuries, people, it wasn't until then, in early modern times, that people really became aware that these were monuments. As we know, at Avebury, for example, people just dug the stones up, broke them up, and used them to build pigsties, for example. So this idea of reverence of monuments is really quite recent. And when the early antiquarians wrote about them, made the educated classes aware of this, it built up. And it is then the development of archaeology, where people began to understand a little bit more about the layers of time that were involved, and trying to understand what was happening. And more information, and in recent decades, two particular areas of development in archaeology, and in, you know, even in Earth Mysteries, the ability to go to a site, a stone circle, whatever it might be, and see how it fitted into the landscape. Did it align to planetary or stars? Did it align to a sacred peak in the distance? I mean, the Hurler's stones on Bodmin Moor.
Show, folks. This is your host, Andy Gurvich. Our guest this week is the researcher Paul Devereux. Paul is the founding co-editor of Time and Mind, the Journal of Archaeology, Consciousness, and Culture. He is a research affiliate at the Royal College of Art, a fellow of the Royal Society of Arts, and a senior research fellow for the International Consciousness Research Laboratories Group at Princeton. Paul is also an honorary member of the Scientific and Medical Network. Mr. Devereux started out as a painter, having a degree in fine arts. He participated in numerous groups, exhibitions in Britain. He's also exhibited in Germany. His painting became increasingly inspired by the geometry and numinosity of ancient monuments, and this began to lead him deeper into an interest in archaeology. This resulted in him turning more toward writing and research, with the consequence that he slowly shifted from painting and gradually relinquished his formal teaching of painting, drawing, and photography. His research interests in archaeology focus especially on cognitive aspects, trying to, quote, get inside the prehistoric mind. And this has broadened into a study of anthropological themes, especially in what is known as the anthropology of consciousness. This in turn led him to become involved more generally in what is loosely termed consciousness studies. He's frequently combined these themes, such as writing a prehistory of the use of mind-altering substances and examining anomalous phenomena of various kinds, especially supposed psi phenomena. This mix of archaeological, anthropological, and consciousness studies interests has led him to the co-founding and co-editing of the peer-reviewed academic publication we previously mentioned, the Time and Mind Journal of Archaeology, Consciousness, and Culture. For 20 years, from 1976 to 1996, Paul Devereux edited and published the legendary The Ley Hunter Journal, eventually deconstructing the modern myths of ley lines. Can't wait to get into that with you, for which he has not been forgiven in some quarters. But his authentic and documented research into spirit and death roads across archaic landscapes developed directly from his early lay interests. For more on that, see the book Spirit Roads, which we'll get into in a minute. Paul's given a great many presentations on various aspects of his multidisciplinary range of subject matter to specialist, academic, and general audiences in Britain, Ireland, the United States, Canada, Germany, Norway, Holland, Switzerland, Italy, France, and many more. Venues have ranged from Glastonbury New Age Fairs to some of the most prestigious universities and institutions in England and America. His portfolio of written work includes 26 published English language books, plus numerous foreign language editions, many articles for popular and specialist magazines, including being archaeology columnist for Fortean Times magazine, plus a range of peer-reviewed academic papers. He has additionally conceived, co-produced, or appeared in television documentaries in the UK and the United States. Currently a research affiliate with the Royal College of Art, working on an audiovisual study. Paul, I'm going to butcher the name, so you'll have to let me know in a second here. Is it Munns Presley? The source area in Wales of the Stone Age bluestones. A lengthy introduction, but welcome to the show, Paul.
Thank you, Andy.
Tell me how I just butchered the name of the mound in Wales where the Stonehenge bluestones are from. How do we pronounce that?
That's Carn Menyn.
Okay.
And it's on the Preseli Hill Range in southwest Wales. And it's a sort of bare, windswept ridge with a lot of rock outcrops, quite large ones. And they fingerprinted the bluestones to various ones of those.
I want to get into the bluestone conversation with you in a second, but I thought, why don't we start off with what is on everybody's mind lately, and that's international politics.
Yeah.
Things in the United States and Britain have been very interesting lately. So our show here is a show about consciousness, creativity, and transformation. We tend to stay away from, you know, left, right, you know, topical sorts of political issues. But I would be remiss if I didn't ask you if you had any comments on the American election and on the Brexit vote.
Sure. It's certainly changing the world. I voted to stay in the EU, so I wasn't one of the Brexiteers, as they're called. I think it was a ill-informed event, the referendum. It wasn't properly conducted. Nobody was really informed, and there was a lot of people who were dissatisfied with the neoliberal agenda we've had for 30-odd years, which has led to the decline in jobs in certain communities and various other things. And they just wanted to give the establishment a kicking. Unfortunately, there are ramifications and consequences which they certainly were not considering. And so the Leave EU campaign in Britain, the Brexit campaign, won by a very thin majority. And it only involved in all about a third of the population. I'm furious about it because I don't think it's a basis on which to pitch the country into major monumental constitutional change and disarray. So it's a right old mess. The people running it, the politicians, are not cross-party. They're just Conservative Tory Party people, handful. And I don't know what their IQs would add up to. Pretty good if you added them all together. but otherwise, I it's going to have tremendous effects on research in this country. We get a lot of our research funding from the European Union, the EU, and now we won't. And I don't think we can rely on the government to make up the difference. They may initially, but it won't last long. So a lot of our collaborative efforts and research efforts, Britain will be at the back of the queue and may not even get on at all. And already some British researchers in all fields, you know, scientific and artistic, are being turned down because of the uncertain future. So there's that. It's no good saying people were stupid. They were certainly misled. They'll live, I'm sure, to regret it. The trouble is, we all will as well. As far as the American thing, I predicted that Trump would win. So I wasn't surprised, like a lot of other people. It was a choice between two pretty poor apples.
Yeah.
And what worries me more than Trump per se winning is the way the Republicans have got the grip of the House, and they'll have the choice of putting in a right winger in the Supreme Court.
Yes, sir.
So from stem to stern, America will be ruled by right wing elite. And I don't think the people who voted Trump really understood that. Sure they didn't. and they'll live to regret that too. The people who believe the rhetoric that Trump came out with in amongst his obscenities and other things will also not, will find that they're not fulfilled his promises. He was oversimplistic, and I thought when he was shown to the White House by Obama, he looked like a little schoolboy, and he looked a little frightened to me.
Yeah.
That's certainly what happened here. The politicians who had pushed, the lead politicians who had pushed for Brexit, not expecting it to happen, but were doing it for their own political agendas. The day after, they were ashen-faced.
Yeah.
They fell out amongst themselves. They didn't know what to do, and still there's not a Brexit plan of any coherence. And I think you'll find something similar over in your fine land, which we love and which we're very fearful for, but not only for America, but for the rest of the world too, because of America's influence on things, economic, military, and otherwise. So it is a very worrying time, and what I'm seeing, if I summed it up in a phrase or two, would be I'm seeing a huge right-wing, well, I think Bill Maher called it a slow-motion coup, and I think we're looking at a right-wing shift, extreme right-wing shift, actually, in the Western world generally, in the States, of course, now we're here in Brexit land, in France with Le Pen, and most of the Western European countries are now under threat, if not already, of governance by extreme right-wing people. And it's as if everybody's forgotten where that leads eventually. But they'll find out. The truth is, we all will, whether we wanted to or not.
Yeah. I think
it rides, the reason it's happening, it rides on a sea, a wave of populism that has been profoundly misled.
Profoundly misled by the right and profoundly ignored, at least in America, by the left, our sort of faux populism.
Oh, the left have got plenty to answer for.
Yeah.
And any outfit, left or right, that's been adopting the Reaganomics and the Thatcherist neoliberal agenda, this is where it's taken us after 35 years. And it's very clear, it's not esoteric, but I doubt if that many people really understand that unless they really pay attention to the history of the matter and understand the mechanics. So, our Labour Party, which is like your Democrats, really has not been doing its job. It's been a lighter version of the right-wing party, the Tories, the Conservatives. So there's been no true challenge to that political, economic agenda. And it's had these consequences. It's a question of who will be brave enough to stand up. You've got Bernie Sanders. He's a good man. Let's start a grassroots refashioning of the economic model. And we'll have to do the same here. We've got a guy called Corbyn and the massive party now, the Labour Party, but it's not doing well in the national polls because, of course, all the very widely read tabloids, newspapers and some of the broadsheets are constantly attacking and constantly running their own agenda, which is extreme right-wing.
Right.
What one of the papers, the Daily Mail, for example, even people like Lego are refusing to advertise with them.
Right.
So when we had a court judgment, I'm sorry to go on about this, but it's something that's been really occupying us. The Prime Minister, Theresa May, is trying to avoid parliamentary, we are a parliamentary democracy, but is trying to avoid the parliamentary oversight to her Brexit negotiations. Hmm. And she's done everything to block it. So a group of people went to the High Court and got a ruling by the judiciary that they would have to open up to Parliament.
Process, yeah.
And they're appealing that at the moment, the Tories. But the Daily Mail and other papers came out saying enemies of the people and have photographs of the judges and so on. And our judiciary is not like your Supreme Court. It is neutral and it's separate. to the political machinations. And it was outrageously awful. Yet the person who owns the Daily Mail is as right-wing as he comes, a non-domicile. It's true of many other of the newspaper owners. They're the very people, that the people who voted Brexit want nothing to do with, but they're influenced by them.
Wow. You know, the reason I ask this, and I think you've done a masterful job of articulating the near history causes for both of these movements in the West, in America and Britain, especially this outright populist rejection of neoliberalist policies. I want to take the question in another direction and maybe use it as a bridge to the other aspects of our conversation. From what I know of your work, and from what I read in your bio, your research interests in archaeology focus especially on cognitive aspects, trying to get, quote unquote, get inside the prehistoric mind. And when we met, it was at an Anthropology of Consciousness conference where you came to speak here in the States. And my work dovetails with yours in studying Neolithic and Paleolithic human organization. And my work specifically mm-hmm. focuses in human religion and human mythological constructs. And so looking specifically at modalities of symbolic consciousness and how they've affected the human perception of their place in the world throughout time. And what I'm seeing here, and I wonder if you can comment on this, is that at the end of the Middle Ages, we had to, here in the Western world, reinvent society. And we did so along these Greek and Roman lines. And that model has been serving us since then, but I feel like we're sort of chugging to the end of that, that it's running out of gas and it's sputtering closed. And so we find ourselves in this in-between time where not only is a new mythology necessary, but we need new models of social organization because these previous Greek and Greco-Roman ones are just simply not working anymore. And we've had various ways of trying to pump them up and keep it alive, various bubbles, economic bubbles, and then these ideological kinds of lurchings in the United States and in England, but they are really signs that the system itself is in trouble. And so I've been thinking, along with others, that that our path forward is to look back to Neolithic and Paleolithic models of human organization. And I don't know if I agree with the paleo communities that say, we're going to have to go back to living in these hunter-gatherer kinds of communities. But I do think we can look to those models for modalities, for templates that can be maybe introduced into the modern world in a way that would make sense for reimagining the way we interact with one another. Does that make any sense to you? And is that a part of the work you do as well? Because, you know, the work you're doing on the island there is so fascinating because it's harkening back to this very thing, to the way the people, the ancestors of your island actually organized themselves in social constructs, and it's quite different from the kinds of considerations we have now. Maybe speak to that a little bit?
Well, that's a nice complex package you've presented me with, Andy. There's yes and no's in my personal views on all that. First thing to remember, I think, is that in Neolithic, never mind Paleolithic, but Neolithic times, there were an awful lot less people around.
Sure.
And we are now very numerous as humans, and answers that might have worked 5,000 years ago probably can't really be applied today in toto.
Absolutely.
Not completely. So I think we have to find our own way to a degree. However, having said that, there are aspects of say, the prehistoric world that I'm particularly interested in, and that is what was their perceptions of the physical topography around them? How did their senses work? Obviously, basically the same as ours, but I think with important differences.
Mm-hmm.
And their closeness to natural rhythms and natural processes was infinitely better than ours. I'm quite concerned, to be honest with you, at the off-earth development of digital technology today. And you see people wandering around. I mean, we did, for the Royal College, we did the work on Preseli, on the bluestone source mm-hmm. areas, to get students away from their goddamn smartphones, away from their digital inputs and their short attention spans, and to sit and listen to the landscape, look at it carefully. Direct sensory perception of the environment. Hmm. I mean, I see people walking across the road, they don't look left or right, their wires going into their ears, and people have their phones on all the time. It's a sort of addiction. There's very little really going on their phones, only occasionally.
Yeah.
I mean, I've got a smartphone, okay, but I use it when I need to use it, not just as a habit.
Yes.
So I think the digital technology is removing us further away from that direct sensory experience. So what we've been doing is trying to explore what would Stone Age eyes see, what would Stone Age ears hear. And it's really an exercise in stripping the senses and really figuring what's there and how we relate to the land, because we don't relate to the land. A lot of kids don't even know where vegetables come from, let alone their daily milk or whatever. And we think that's a joke, but it's actually true.
Mm.
And it's extremely worrying. So as far as social organization goes, well, they're usually tribal in some ways, and that can be troublesome. And we used to think that the Neolithic was rather peaceful, but it's quite clear from excavational work in the last decade or so that there was a lot of fighting. We find loads of flint arrowheads at certain things where there's been some sort of conflict. Sometimes we find the arrowheads inside of skeletons. So it wasn't that peaceful. And people probably lived in fear. And then through the ages, you know, in medieval times, you were afraid of spirits, evil spirits flitting into the house, and all sorts of technology developed to keep the spirits out, witch bottles and spirit catchers and so on. Which we can still see in some remote parts of Europe, still find these devices. And at night you were frightened because revenants could roam the earth. And so that and the heavy hand of religion was crushing really spiritual and mental development. And so it was the Enlightenment, the scientific Enlightenment, that freed us from that, and don't let's underestimate it. The problem now we have is that a lot of, if you like, the mythology of the day is very reductionist, and it's science all or nothing. And you know, for example, they're taking away art history out of our schools now. They're taking away archaeology, incidentally, as well, out of the schools. People are losing track, A, of their immediate environment because of digital technology. B, they are they do not understand the rhythms of history. If they did, they would be more concerned than I hear people being of this great right-wing swing, because there's no way that is going to end up. We've been here before.
Yeah.
The patterns are the same. And nobody seems to analyze it. So there has to be a shake-up. The economic model has to change. We have to try to... It's hard to say, because the other problem with the technological developments are things like television and so on, where everything's a sort of a game, reality shows and so on. That should never, in my view, are a disgusting development.
Yeah.
And I'm pretty sure, I've got a feeling... This is just a presentiment, if you like, that Donald Trump still thought he was in a reality show all the way through the campaign. And I think he's shocked. I saw shock on his face, because even his, what's his, Kellyanne, whatever her name is.
Kellyanne Conway,
I heard her on the television today. So we never expected to win. Now they have. And if they're going to put people like Sarah Palin in their administration, I won't shoot myself. simply.
Department of Interior.
The fact that they don't accept climate change as a reality.
Mm-hmm.
These things are profoundly disturbing, and we have to stand up against it.
You couldn't be
more
correct.
That's a bit off theme, what you said. But anyway, I think there are elements we can take from the Neolithic world. And I think there are certain things that can't be applied to our present condition.
You bring up something interesting there, and I first a comment and then a further question before we go to our first break here. When you were talking about the digital gap, you know, much has been written about this new digital world we find ourselves in the world of social media, and it's a very complex thing, as you've suggested, because so much connectivity. I mean, the very fact that we're able to have this conversation right now across the water,
mm-hmm.
so much organizing, so much positive can come from and has come from social media and from the ability of people to connect and share information. At the same time, so much disinformation, so much faulty news, so much spreading of hateful and misogynistic and incorrect kinds of memes. And so one of the things that people are starting to look at is how this new digital information age is actually making democracy more difficult. And two of the ways that we're just looking into now, and I think we're just starting to study this, is, like you said, this digital gap. Not only when we're walking around with our heads buried in these phones, are we separating ourselves from the landscape and the rhythms and the rhythmic patterns of our connection to the landscape, but we're separating ourselves from one another. Because to communicate with somebody on Facebook is not the same thing as standing in front of them and looking them in the eye. Oxytocin is not released.
Mm-hmm.
We have a very different thing. And then the other thing I would ask, comment on and get maybe your comment back on, is our ability to process this amount of information. We are deluged daily with more information than we're really able to process. And this is a brand new thing for us. If we want to talk about going back to the Neolithic, in one sense, you know, we are encountering and processing massive amounts of information on a daily basis when we are interacting with the landscape, building a pharmacopoeia. So in that sense, we're constantly taking in data back in that mindset. But in this digital age, they've shown studies that people won't even click into a Facebook article. They will just see the headline and then respond to it vociferously in the affirmative or the negative. And so this rising gap between one another, and then this inability for us to process all of this information, I think also is leading completely to this difficulty. But the question I had for you goes back to art. I just was able to work with the Joseph Campbell Foundation to write the introduction for a book on Indonesian tribal art, the largest book on Indonesian tribal art ever produced. And I was really interested in, you know, although Campbell is a scholar, you know, not without criticism and that a lot of folks, you know, don't follow, I was interested in some of his thinking on art. And this goes back to, you know, your early years as an artist. And Campbell said some interesting things about, real artist is the one who has learned to recognize and to render the radiance of all things as an epiphany or showing forth of truth. You know, he talked regularly about artists being able to connect to these rhythmic patterns and then show them forth in a kind of radiance that makes them evident to the viewer and to the participant. And that sanctimonious or religious art, in proper, it always has this showing forth capacity. And when I hear you talking about bringing students out to stare at the landscape and really see it, I see an element of this there, this ability of that we've lost of really being able to see these rhythmic patterns within our perceptual frameworks and connect those to our understanding of our place in the cosmos. So I wonder, I'm sure there's a question in there somewhere, but maybe you can elaborate on that and talk about how art...
Okay, let me dig in there. There's a lot of strands.
A lot of strands, yeah. This is my American attention deficit disorder, so I'll just throw the whole kitchen sink at you and you can find a path forward.
One of the things I would say is, I remember an anthropologist saying, once upon a time, when you said you'd call somebody, you called across the village, across the clearing, now we can call somebody, as we are doing here, from opposite sides of the world. So in some ways, it's wonderful.
Yeah.
At the same way that you can use the internet to research in ways we couldn't so rapidly before, and that's wonderful, if you know what it is you're researching.
Mm.
If you don't know that, then you get all this guff that comes across that looks shiny and nice and totally misinforms you.
Yes.
And also, yes, the prejudice has come through the whole thing. So it's a mess that's not really sorted. And yes, we have so many data points to process in our daily lives, enormous amounts of stuff that the human brain never had to do. And so you can imagine the relatively silent, relatively simple world our distant ancestors used to live in. And we are bombarded now. That, as far as art goes, art works if it gives you a punch of numinosity in the stomach. Anything that does that is, in my view, art.
Mm.
If it doesn't do that, and I see a lot of modern art I'm not really keen on, that's really at the level of advertising imagery.
Mm.
It doesn't have depth. But on a more general level, art is the most useless thing on earth, and yet it's the one real feature, perhaps along with language, that differentiates us from other living creatures on the earth.
Mm.
So why do we have it? What is this urge to art all about? I can't give you the answer, but it's definitely it's very important. Yet it's in today's culture. Educationally, and that it's often pressed down the line as very secondary importance.
How secondary importance now? But when your study of ancient shamanism and rock art, what did you did you come to some conclusions on what it meant?
Well,
to
I mean,
early
it goes back to the point that I think art has always been key to being a human being,
mm-hmm.
and it was instinctive, like singing in the rain or whatever, and speech. These are urges that have developed in the human being. And art is something they did. Now, art often have religious connotations and ritual connotations, but there's also a joy in it. You only have to look at the Paleolithic cave. You see somewhere like Shobe, the beautiful lines of the tigers and the horses and so on. Freedom. These are beautiful things. And also what's often not realized is that they use the undulations of the rock wall to give a sort of a relief quality to the drawings. So again, it was that close observation of the physical world, perhaps by a flickering torchlight in a deep cave. And they would see the shadows moving, and out of that came the actual rock art itself.
I have one.
In some places, the rock art is the result of notation by shamans who would take whatever potion or other, and would then go into a trance, meet the spirits, often perceived as being behind rock faces, and when they came back, they would put down this imagery that was the spirit's writing, which we would now call entoptic imagery. And I had a mild heart attack, well, I had a stroke, mini stroke, some years ago. And I was amazed. For 2 days, whenever I looked at a wall, for example, a plain colored wall, I would see the most immaculate arabesque as if printed directly on it. It had the same spatial quality as the wall itself.
Wow.
And I couldn't believe it. Then I realized this is just what these guys saw with their datura or psilocybin or whatever it was they were taking, their plants, their magical plants. And they would see these things, and this was the writing of the spirits. So some rock art is that. Other rock art has sort of ritual attributes, maybe hunting attributes, and so on. But the urge to make the mark. And then you go, I've been walking across Death Valley, and in remote parts of Death Valley are these vast geoglyphs, ground drawings and markings left by shamans doing their vision quest perhaps 2,000 years ago.
Hmm.
They're not very well known, these places, in because they're very fragile, can easily be destroyed. I went to see one that was last reported on 12 years previously, and it was a low ring of rocks forming a vision quest site. And when I got there, the rocks had been collected up, and the name Alex had been written out with the the small rocks, and that's where that one went. A lot of different things, but the urge to make marks on a vast scale, the Nazca lines and all the rest of it, and the rock mosaics that you find up, for example, in Canada, left by Indians 1,500 years ago, the ringing rocks that's involved in some of them, so you can hear the sounds that they heard over a millennium ago, and the urge to leave a mark, to use the magical power of art in its broadest sense, has been with us a long, long time. And I still don't think we've really understood what that urge is all about.
I want to go to our first break, and then I want to come back and ask you about ley lines and ask you some questions about the long trip and archaeoacoustics. Okay. Does that work for you?
Sure thing.
Wonderful.
I'll
folks,
take a drink of water.
You do get hydrated. We appreciate that. You're listening to On the Block Radio, folks. This is your host, Andy Gervich. Our guest is the researcher, Paul Devereux. We will be right back after these words.
You've been listening to On the Block, a podcast for bonobos only. No chimps allowed. Be right back.
There are a lot of people who come here week after week after week, and they just simply sit and look at the stones, or stand and look at the stones. There is most definitely a magic about them. There's an aura.
Welcome to Stonehenge, perhaps the most famous monument in the world. Its circle of giant stones standing for centuries on Salisbury Plain as one of the great mysteries of civilization. Sharon White describes the scene.
What we regard as Stonehenge, the stone circle, is only a small part of a very large ancient and archaeological area. There are, on the skyline, as you, if you stand at Stonehenge and look around, you'll see the ancient burial mounds of the families that actually built Stonehenge. There's some 400 of them within sight if you know where to look for them.
And once you do know, the entire area takes on an extremely eerie feeling as you realize you are walking where others before you walked thousands of years earlier. So, what exactly is Stonehenge, and why was it built?
The mystery of Stonehenge is the fact that we don't actually know, and I hope we never do really find out. But yes, it was almost certain to have been for some ceremonial use. You don't go to that much effort over a period of 1,500 years to come up with something that has no significance. It was probably the sun, because everything points towards the summer sunrise, the summer solstice. The sun actually rises over a stone we call the hillstone and shines directly through across the altar stone and out through the main, the large trilithon on the particular time of the summer solstice. But on the other hand, we also have the people who say if you turn around and look the other way, the moon at its highest point also does the reverse. So there again we have, was it the sun or was it the moon? There is the belief that it was some massive calendar, that it was something to do with fertility rites, and where the sun was shining through like a major sundial, if you like, told them when to plant their crops, when to harvest their crops. I mean, there are so many different versions, and I mean, that's the magic of it. That's why it's magic.
We'll be right back. You're listening to On the Block Radio.
Okay, welcome back to the program, folks. This is your host, Andy Gervish. We're speaking with Paul Devereux, and when we left, we were talking about several things, including the impulse to art that has been with us as a species for, as far as we can tell, most of our existence, something that we still are examining in terms of figuring out why that is. And I wanted to ask you a few questions. I became aware of your work, as I'm sure some folks here in the States did, with The Long Trip. The book on the prehistory of psychedelia and the use of plant hallucinogens in prehistoric ritualized settings, and then started diving backwards into all the stuff you'd done previous to that. But a question about that, you know, you have a great image on the cover of the book that's from, I believe, the Chatal Hayek site, and I'm interested in, you know, I was watching Gabor Mate recently, and he was talking about sort of our modern use of psychedelics, and he was talking about addiction in particular, but he was talking about psychedelics as well, and he was saying that in the modern context, you know, people tend to go to these substances for one of two things, either pure escapism from pain and suffering, or as a way to try to confront deep wounding and separation in their own life, familial kinds of things. And so people, you know, go to Central and South America to take ayahuasca to try to process, you know, parental abuse or, you know, various kinds of things that have led to them, you know, having a life not that they, you know, that they thought they were going to have. And so this seems to be a newer thing, this going to these substances to escape the reality of our suffering or to try to confront it in a certain way. And I'm wondering if you can speak to the shift in that, because my reading of your book, this is not the sort of traditional use of these substances in an archaic sense.
Well, again, it's a complex matter. You know, either you're a psychonaut here today, and you are really exploring consciousness with these substances, your own and generally. Or one takes them, if you like, for, quote, hedonistic purposes, which to a degree can be okay, but it can also cheapen the experience. And then there's the social problems that have come with it, where people get addicted to things. You don't get addicted by psychedelics except to become psychologically addicted.
Sure.
But with other substances, there's a physical addiction that goes with it. That's destructive. There's no, how can I put this, a cultural context for it. I don't know whether you ever read Aldous Huxley's Island. And for any of your listeners, anybody who hasn't should. Because Huxley, who had contact with very briefly shortly before his death, Huxley had a tremendous prescience. He knew what was coming, just like, 1984?
Orwell.
Yeah, in the political sense. But he, you know, his Brave New World is true, it's coming true. His Doors of Perception and Heaven and Hell were important essays on the use of mescaline.
Absolutely.
But his Island is really the social context thing. What he suggested and what he felt was that these mind-altering substances should be treated sacramentally, as they were in most tribal cultures in the past and still in a few cases the present, and not used as escapist stuff. So he was all for them to be used sacramentally, and there to be places with fully beautiful mind-altering places where everybody would go through a ritual in their teens, say, so that at least once in their life they would contact this greater consciousness. And then if they wanted to develop that, they could do it. And of course, in the novel Island, it all gets shot up in the end as an uprising or whatever, and that piece of wisdom is lost.
Huh.
But on the island, they had minor birds, which they had trained, and they flew around to remind people of their consciousness of being aware. And they would say, and his book ends with a minor bird, minor birds talking, saying, attention, attention. And that's how it ends, because we lose attention.
Huh.
So there's a tremendous role, and a lot of people are working on this, in my view, to use psychedelics, mind-altering substances, in a really positive way. And there is work going on, and after long decades of drought, as it were, permission is being granted by governments to here and there allow proper research into them and their effects on the brain. Now we have fMRI and so on. We can actually see what's happening in the brain a lot better than we ever could. Positive use of technology again. So
yeah, Rick Strassman's going to be on the show in the coming weeks after you, and he's done some great work in that area here in the States.
Who, sorry?
Dr. Rick Strassman, who wrote the DM.
Oh, yes, good man.
Yeah.
I was in touch with him, too.
So how important are sites like...
Simon. Of course, there's stuff going on here, you know, with the Beckley Foundation.
Yes.
And I've been there as well with a few... Anyway, I'm going to that.
How important are sites like Göbekli Tepe and Şatıl Hayek for our understanding of this time period and this shift, I guess, from...
Well, let me tell you something.
Yeah.
This is bringing it back to archaeology. Excuse me while I have a drink.
Please, take your time.
On the Isle of Orkney, well, a series of islands, but in mainland Orkney, which is off the top coast of the north coast of Scotland, there's tremendous Neolithic, megalithic remains there, all sorts and descriptions, and major, major megalithic monuments. And for a long, long while, there was this hill that everybody thought was natural. But then, I forget quite how it was discovered, but there was structures inside of it. And now, they've been about the last 4 or 5 years, been excavating it, stage by stage, and still more excavations to go. But what it has revealed is a center. It wasn't for living in. It was clearly a series of what they say are temples, and there's markings on the stones like writing. There's these handheld stones that are perfect geometrical shapes. A whole range of stuff. Now, my guess, and they had a wall around it. It was brightly colored in the original, and we can still get elements of the color of some of the walls.
Wow.
Some of which were perhaps 3 meters high. You know, they were. And this set, this cluster of buildings, and my guess is only my interpretation, but I think this was a center of education. I think there was geometry taught there. I think there was mind-altering substances used there, a whole range of things.
Mm-hmm.
And it was the center of Western European culture. And some of the pottery, the sort of designs on the pottery, the grooved ware, are found certainly in Britain from one end of the island to the other, 1,000 miles apart. And there clearly was some sort of like cult, or there was priests or priestesses traveling the country, and in different Neolithic communities, these things were used. And there's just a hint here and there with one or two clues that they may have contained mind-altering substances like henbane and so on.
Mm-hmm.
So my guess is there was such a center, in at least in Neolithic Britain, and the center was at the furthest point north, which now nobody thinks about it, all London and the, you know, southern England. And also possibly further afield than just the British Isles. And also a tremendous developments in Ireland at the Neolithic level monuments. So there was a lot of knowledge and wisdom, deep insight going on. And it would be nice if we had such things in our culture today, which would take a different form, of course, but it would use mind-enhancing substances. It would use... Like in the Glasperlenspiel, the bead game,
Hermann Hesse.
This would be the master game, the knowledge, the putting together of things. What we would say would now be cross-disciplinary. We need those centres. We need that cultural impetus within us, and I think that'll be really what you were saying, that unfortunately, the way the digital world is going, there's so much out there, there's so much processing. Unless somebody's had a good educational foundation in the first place, I don't think they can process it. They just receive stuff. And so you get all this wild and wacky stuff, and some of it politically sinister stuff is flying out there. And people are just thrown into this vast ocean of digital tumult.
Without a grounding, without an initiation into the world of the living. Yeah.
So I personally would like to see that happening again, and that once you've touched the deep levels of the other world, the mental state, you're never quite the same again. And you may go on and explore that further, or you may just bring it back into your normal everyday life. But it gives you a background, and you don't calmly kill people. You don't calmly speak your mouth off in insightful and hateful ways, in theory at any rate. So but you can't. We're nowhere near getting anybody convinced to do that on a social scale. Okay, I'll be honest with you. I'm extremely dubious about the survival of our culture. I'll be honest with you about that. I didn't used to be. I used to be very positive. I'm less so now.
What was the change? These recent developments with Brexit and Trump and things like
that? No, I've been seeing it happen in dribs and drabs for some time. But certainly, 2016 has really put the garnishing on the top of that.
hasn't it, though? Yes, sir. Oh, boy.
So we'll have to wait to see how it happens, but we'll have to be very alert to not let things slide away into something awful.
Yeah, and, you know, I wonder how much of a collapse will be necessary before something new can be built in its place, and that's going to be a very turbulent and difficult time.
Just my wife says that. She says perhaps we have to go down a rock bottom and everybody wake up.
Yeah.
But did they wake up in 1930s Germany? I don't know.
Right, that's the thing, is we have no guarantee that the wake-up will be a positive one. It could push us further into totalitarianism.
Well, at the moment, it's an extreme right-wing wave is passing over us. And, you know, I come out of the 60s and, full of psychedelics, full of hope, full of idealism, full of brightness. And I never thought, decades on, I'd be living in a world that's turning like this.
Boy, you said it there. You know, and when I had been filled with so much hope as well, and still am, but I have some of the same concerns you do. I was excited last year to see the discovery of the cave art in Sulawesi that mirrors that of Chauvet and the other places, because this moved the locus of this Paleolithic symbolic consciousness out of Southern Europe and into Indonesia. And I think, you know, things that are moving away from Eurocentrism at the moment, in terms of our understanding of sort of global consciousness movements are welcomed. I want to ask you about archaeoacoustics a little bit before our time runs out here, because I probably incorrectly go around telling people that you are the founder of this movement. So maybe you can...
No, if only I was, eh?
Yeah, right?
But I am one of the earlier pioneers.
Yeah, at least since the 90s, early 90s, you've been working on this steadily, yeah?
Yes. Working with a group called ICRL that was then based in Princeton. And we had a look at, for reasons too long really to go into, but we decided to go and look at some of the chambered Neolithic monuments in southern England and in Ireland, ending up at the great Newgrange site. And we just wanted to find out what... We had an experience in Aztec, in New Mexico, in a kiva, an Anasazi kiva, where they were playing Hopi Indian kiva chants. And we were aware that they were resonant inside that space. So we thought, well, let's check out the Stone Age, because we actually know nothing about the Stone Age, really, in Europe, and the people very much. So we thought, well, let's try and see what the resonance is inside these places. And we went around and used the sound thing, loudspeaker, and monitored the waves and wait to get the basic resonance, the fundamental frequency, sound, audio frequency. And we found recurring was this 110 hertz and 111, 112 hertz, that sort of thing. And it seemed that they only gave that thing because of various modifications to the chamber. And that was true at Newgrange, which was exactly 110 hertz resonance, fundamental resonance. And there were various other things. People said, well, you know, there's rock art in Newgrange. And we said, well, in the sort of wave pattern, the standing wave, has the same number of nodes and troughs as these rock art patterns and so on. People said, well, they wouldn't know that, would they? Well, interestingly, if at midwinter the sun rises and shines down at Newgrange, down the 70-foot long entrance passage, and lights up the 3-meter-high chamber there, and the rocks glow like copper, glowing copper all around for about 17 minutes before the sun moves out. And there's a special box that allows the sunbeam in. It's very carefully constructed. The ground rises in a certain way. We said, well, there are these stone bowls in these alcoves around the edge of the chamber. And we do know that in the Iron Age people in Ireland had something akin to sweat lodges, a bit very similar.
Hmm.
And there's been much debate what they really were, but they were basically sweat lodges. And if there had been steam produced, for example, inside, it's pure speculation, but it's possible. If steam was produced inside the central chamber at Newgrange, and there was a group of people there chanting away, the deep 110 hertz is around bass 8. It's sort of deep baritone range, acoustic range. And if they were doing the deep sort of whatever sort of thing, the sunbeam comes in like a laser, and it would cut through the particulate matter of you know, if the room was filled with steam, or for that matter, or with incense. And if you were producing the sound, vocally intoning this on a very steady level, the sound wave would develop, and it would organize the particulate matter in the atmosphere, in the steamy or incense-filled atmosphere, and you would actually see a black shape, of a moving black shape of the pattern, sound pattern. So they could see the pattern of the sound. Now, that may sound crazy, but what we did for one of our TV things was, well, we had a long plastic tube, about a foot wide in diameter, blocked it at both ends, laid some fungi spores along the bottom, set a sound that was resonant for the inside of the tube, had a beam of light shining through, absolutely sealed off. And what we saw when we filmed this, the spores rose up as if by magic of their own accord and took the form of the sound wave. So we know it could have happened. And this is all areas that need a lot of research, but, you know, at least we found that and we've left a record of the possibility. So anything could be happening that's hardly been looked at yet. That was one level of acoustics. We were doing that. I personally got involved with ringing rocks, lithophones, because around the ancient world, rocks that made a ringing noise, musical sounds, when you tapped them, became highly venerated or respected in different ways. In the Americas, it was assumed as a spirit there, and the sound was from the spirits. In China, they had a thing called Bein Shi, which meant ringing rocks, resonant rocks.
Hmm.
And these were considered extremely powerful condensers of qi. All rocks were thought to be condensers of qi. And if you were a Chinese traveler around about 1,000 years ago and you're toddling along a country track and you came across a great big boulder of immense proportions, if you sat by it, the qi in it would be give a good charge to your own qi pattern, helping your health and general well-being. But rocks that were unusually shaped and or could make sound, resonant ringing sounds, like Jasper Bells, as one poet of the 11th century put it.
Yeah, church bells, right, are an early form of this.
Sorry?
Said an early form of the church bell in one way, right? Call to worship, yeah.
The point is, it's happening all over the world. The Indians, in their temples, have rocks that ring beautifully, some of them giving the notes of the bass notes of classical Indian music.
Wow.
High level of Stone Age technology. So I got interested in all that, both the cross-cultural look and learning. That's how we got into checking if the blue stones of Stonehenge came from an area that had that was a soundscape. And so we went to Preseli, went to the source areas of the blue stones, sometimes with our students, sometimes with friends and relatives. But basically, my colleague John Wozencroft and I were the main instigators. And we studied these over several years, making as many trips as we could in that time. And there was a village, there is a village called Maenclochog in the heart of Preseli. And that actually means ringing rock, that name.
Huh.
And they, up until the 18th century, they had two blue stones, which they used for church bells. They didn't have metal bells at all. They used the rocks themselves. And then some bright spark comes along, breaks them up, and uses them for packing up a new road that was going through. So there's a tremendous history. This is, to me, is the basis of musical history. And there's a chap called Bernard Fagg, who was one of the great pioneers in the 1950s, who did a lot of work in Africa. And many places in Africa have ringing rocks. And they used to use them like they use drums. And some rocks, there's so many of them, they could actually produce melodies on them. And there'd be priests who would use the rocks, beat on the rocks, and so on. So we've been making a huge sound library of these rock sounds. Some sound like tin drums, some sound as pure as bells. And you see, normally when you hit on a rock, it's just a dull thud or clunk. But these, for some reason, these particular rocks will ring, and we don't quite know why. There's various theories. So that got me involved, and I should say, there's a plug coming up here, but the March issue of Time and Mind is a special issue on Archaeal Acoustics.
Really?
And it'd be everything from Chavin to Wontar to ringing rocks in Vietnam. There'll be a huge range of research material in it.
I have a couple of follow-up questions on that, because this is really fascinating to me. I know that you've done some work, published at least one article with a colleague of mine, and I guess a colleague of yours, Stanley Krippner, on dream studies and sacred sites. And when I met you in Chicago, we spoke briefly about this. And I know Stanley was very instrumental in Mickey Hart from the Grateful Dead. He taught him a lot about this shamanic drumming and its use in altering consciousness and affecting dream state, especially in, you know, Jung studied this in Africa as well. And so this use of rhythmic patterns, this use of of sound to alter consciousness is something that goes, as you say, well back into our species. And like other forms of artistic expression, these musical forms, these rhythmic forms, have always attended ceremony to alter consciousness in some way. And so I just wanted to ask you two things about that. One of them is about the cave art, because I remember reading an article in The Guardian, but I thought you were part of this conversation about cave art in Spain, where a study was done where we're going through the caves with in total darkness and looking for that echo, for that resonance, and when they found the right pitch, they would turn their lights on and they would inevitably be in front of one of the more sacred panels in the cave. And so they found that in the places where the most sacred art was, there would be sometimes stalactites or stalagmites that were actually ringing rocks, or they would find some resonance in the chamber itself. Do you know about that?
Oh yeah. Well, guy called Igor Reznikov.
Yes.
He's got a wonderful voice, and he did research a decade or two ago in the Paleolithic painted cave. And he tested the voice against certain surfaces, excuse me, some of which would be marked with a little red or black geometric mark.
Sure.
And these were highly resonant reflective surfaces. And yes, a lot of the rock art itself, the visuals have a sort of soundtrack with them. That happens also in rock art in Southern Africa. It's also true some of the rock shelters in the Lower Pecos area on the Rio Grande. There's one there called White Shaman's Cave, which is absolutely remarkable. And some of these places could actually broadcast sound over that really unexpected distances.
Whoa.
Others could pick up sound from the environment like a microphone. And certainly in the Paleolithic painted caves, also in the caves, there are calcite deposits like stalactites and stalagmites and other calcite structures. And some of these, we can see this forensically, that if you hit them, sometimes very lightly, you'll get harp-like noise or a bell-like noise or whatever.
Hmm.
And often near a surface where there's rock art. And this was discovered by a woman archaeologist, a Dutch archaeologist lady, back in the 1980s and before. So we know these. You can see through layers of calcite that there were percussion marks on some of these calcite deposits. So you can actually hear what they heard 30,000 years ago.
Wow.
And they're very pure. And you have to be very delicate, otherwise you'd break the calcite deposits. So sound and rock art goes together. In Ontario, there's One Echo Park. There's a huge cliff face in the middle of Mazinaw Lake. And this is Mazinaw rock. And There's thousand-year-old rock art paintings in red ochre near just above the water surface, and it's called Bon Echo Park because this rock base gives off exceptional echoes, and it's where the echoes are strongest. That's where the rock art panels cluster.
Boy, that's remarkable.
Other ways sound is produced. I mean. Also, if petroglyph rock in Ontario, near Peterborough, Ontario, there's a rock surface that has about 900 carvings on it. We wondered if it was an acoustic connection with this. And we asked around, we asked the wardens who were there all the time. And they say, yeah, look, there's a big crack running across the face of that rock surface. And occasionally, groundwater runs along the bottom of it. It's about 5 meters deep, this crevice. And the sound that comes up, it sounds like whispering human voices.
Wow.
And we guess that the reason so much rock art on this thing, that it was probably used as an oracle center, because we know a lot of the ancient Greek oracle centers relied on sound in various ways, so they could be interpreted as the sounds of Zeus or whatever in answer to questions.
That's fascinating. One of the things we spoke about as well the last time I saw you were Tuvan singers, and I believe you floated the concept that originally the dual tone was not produced in the voice of the singer themselves, but that they would tune themselves to a particular facet of the landscape, of the topography, and sing into a canyon or into a cave or into some part of the topography, and the land would produce the second tone, the reverberation that would come back, and the two tones would be created
Right. Well, you know, certainly like rushing rivers.
Yeah.
There's been work done in Norway and other places on this. Rivers change their sound, you know, where there's rapids or whatever, white water, or where swirls in some way, and there's eddies and currents and whirlpools, they make different sounds. Certainly in Australia, Australasia generally, Aboriginal peoples think that water places that make sounds are the sounds of the spirits. Hmm. What we find in Europe is that the rock art, Bronze Age, Neolithic rock art panels, are placed along some of these rivers just where the sound of the river changes.
Hmm.
And so there's that sort of thing. Yes, canyons are particularly resonant places. And again, you find rock art where the echoes come back really strongly and are echo-related. There's various people working on this aspect of the landscape. And then the Tuvan throat singers, for example, in Siberia, wherever they are, they were the master technician. They use their bodies for making the sound, the throat singers. And now they do platform presentations. But the origins of that were to make the places speak to them. And really, we're talking echoes here.
Yeah.
And they would find the exact place, had to be at the exact right temperature. It was absolute specific, if you like, scientific almost, in front of a cliff face or in a cave or whatever. And then they would start their throat singing and perfect echoes would come back. And that would be connecting to the spirit of the place, the genie, Loki, whatever you want to call it. And that's how it originated. It wasn't a musical performance. It was in the service of this connection to the land using sound. And there's lots of this stuff. I mean, look, I mean, I've written a bit on it in the Stone Age soundtracks. As I say, we've been doing stuff in Time and Mind, quite a lot of papers, and over this special issue in March. Special issue on archaeoacoustics.
I'm going to ask you, we only have a few minutes left, I have a couple of closing questions, but I'm going to ask you about Time and Mind in a minute, and we'll have links to the journal that folks can order it and get subscribed to it on our website when this episode goes up, because it's fantastic. I've never been so honored to be rejected by a journal in my life for submitting. I'll tell you.
Well, don't blame me alone.
Yeah.
I have to plash stuff around for peer review.
Absolutely, not at all.
I thought it was beautifully presented, I must say.
Well, thank you so much.
It might have overreached itself slightly.
Yeah, I've been...
not between you and me, necessarily.
Yeah.
in strict scholarly fashion. It was scholarly.
Yes.
But perhaps overreached its implications.
The
idea of hand markings that are intriguing that you see on rock faces. I've looked at some in Mexico. What is it? You know, why did they do that?
Right.
Same in Paleolithic caves as well.
I read an article recently.
We had actually, just to say, we had an issue on not only hand markings, but on markings, scrapings on the walls of Paleolithic caves, which seem to have been done by 13, 14-year-old kids.
Isn't that something?
But they seem to have meaning, like it was early writing or something. We know so little.
That's a fascinating thing to me, is that those etches are actually an early form of written text. That's a brilliant idea that I think some folks are just looking into. Again, an archaeologist from Canada, a woman, has been leading on that I'm forgetting her name, but fascinating. I read an article recently, before we go on to our last couple of questions, or just to finish up on this archaeoacoustics, that talked about music in church service, and it looked at how brain patterns, and how in most sacred ceremonies, when one goes to a Baptist church in the United States or Catholic church, that these ceremonies frequently or almost always begin with music or singing and or chanting, and this is done to sort of tune collective consciousness towards this ritualized activity, that they found it's one of the most effective things at bringing people into a sort of collective awareness.
Indeed. And don't forget, Gregorian plain chant seems to have been devised to work in Gothic space. So it resonates perfectly there, which would enhance that effect you're talking of.
Utterly fascinating. A couple questions before we let you go. I would be remiss without asking you about the Lay Hunter Journal and all of the controversy surrounding your, as you say, deconstruction of the ley line myths. And so maybe if you wouldn't mind talking a little bit about that and how that all came about and the fallout since, because I'm sure you're still receiving hate mail.
Story. You can read about it in my website, which the one that's up there is fairly old website. I've got a new one being constructed now.
And in the book Spirit Roads.
Story. It's a long piece on Lays, the history, where the idea came from and what this amounted to. But, we looked at it, and I think we came up with it. You've got to understand, it came out of the 1960s, the whole modern lay idea.
Yeah.
The old one with Alfred Watkins, who saw these alignments of sites, which he think were the remnants of old straight tracks. He thought they were traders' tracks, but that they places along them became, you know, as they do at crossroads and things like that.
Not these
whatever would set up there, and some of them became sacred. We do know the crossroads, for example, were considered sacred in medieval times, and various cultures around the world have a belief in that, you know, it's the devil at the crossroads sort of thing.
Sure.
In fact, one day I'll tell you about the experience that Charlotte, my wife, and I had on an Irish crossroads. Very odd. But that's a story for another time.
Sure. with that, how dare you.
That's what he thought they were. And then in the 1930s, that was in the 1920s. In the 1930s, this bloke who was a dowser got hold of him and reckoned he was picking up a cosmic energy along the lines. Then a book was written called, what the hell was it called? What's her name? You can't ask me these things anymore.
I know, right?
anyway, it was an occult novel. And it was... it used the idea of energy lines running across. This was back in, what was it, the 1950s?
Okay.
And then it sort of fell apart. You didn't hear anymore. And then with the rise of the psychedelic decade, a lot of interest started again in this stuff. And all sorts of nonsense was promulgated. And I took on the Lay Hunter Journal, little specialist journal, actually, at that time. And everybody was talking about energy dowsing and all the rest. So I said, okay, great, let's have some papers on it and we'll have some articles. And there was a crushing silence. Nobody had actually researched anything.
Wow.
But there was a lot of stuff flying around in the New Age journals and so on. And anyway, as we progressed, it was clearly there was no basis to the idea of energy lines. There certainly were alignments. I got very interested in actual prehistoric alignments of actual features. And that led into a number of insights, which is in one of my books.
Spirit Roads, correct?
Read one.
Is that,
it was called Shamanism and the Straight Line Mystery.
Okay.
It was really about altered consciousness and the idea of the straight lines in the Americas, for example.
Mm-hmm.
What were they all about? Well, it was a sort of a spirit geography, if you like. They weren't mundane tracks, and when research was done on the Kogi Indians in northern Colombia, they have roads that they march up and down, but the shamanic elite, the elders, they go on what we would call astral journeys now, you know, out-of-body experiences. And they said these physical roads are really just marking pathways in the other world, a lunar.
Hmm.
And they say very few people are using them now.
Yeah.
So we had evidence like that that showed that these things were related to spiritual, psychological experiences by shamans who flew. Shamans fly.
Have you found it difficult to navigate this space where you study these things, as you say in your bio, that are in many cases considered, you know, psi kinds of events, or things that, you know, these saucy things that can exist on the periphery? And for a lot of us, you know, I know when I got into studying Paleolithic religion, you know, I would come across, you know, the Zachariah Sitchin's community and the, you know, the, yeah, the alien overlord species and the Anunnaki, and it would sometimes it would be extremely difficult to separate out where real research was being done and where, yeah, folks were being inundated, yeah, with this kind of cult.
This way, yeah, simple Anglo-Saxon, there's a lot of bollocks out there. there's been a lot of nonsense. I saw in a conference many years ago, I saw Sitchin taken apart. He'd given a talk, and then there was people in the audience who really knew stuff, scientists and so on. And
yeah,
they took it apart. But there you go, still does the rounds.
It still makes the rounds.
And that's the same, the nonsense about ley lines and the St. Michael Lay and all the rest of it. It's always there on the internet.
Mm-hmm.
And, if anybody knows it, it's me. I did 20 years in the front line on lays.
Yeah.
And I know it's rubbish. But, you know, what can you do? What can you say? But, and the rubbish gets better, more widely broadcast than the research stuff.
Yeah, that's what I was going to ask next, is you're constantly fighting that echo chamber.
It's like being in a ham sandwich and you're the ham. On the one hand, you've got the... the orthodoxy, the science-based people who won't touch you with a barge pole and think you're bonkers.
Right.
On the other hand, you've got the New Age. You think you're some foaming scientist in with a white coat or whatever and negating everything.
Who's there to kill all their sacred cows, yeah.
To run that narrow furrow between the New Age and the reactionary scientific.
The reductionist people. Materialist
so
side.
Very,
yeah,
difficult. But we get there. I would say the archaeoacoustics is not in that bag. I've not met an archaeologist, yes, who denies it. You can't deny ringing rock, can you?
No, it's true.
And we know we've got the cultural, anthropological stuff behind it, so there's no two ways about that. And that's one reason, perhaps, why I have focused in on ringing rocks, lithophones, to give the proper term. And I focused in on them because there's no argument about it. What you need to know is collect them, listen to the sounds, perhaps use the sounds in an artistic way, which we are doing, and also trying to understand what they meant to people in different cultural groups in the ancient world.
When you, you know, speaking of these things that, you know, that can maybe exist on the periphery but still require careful and diligent research, when you sent me my, as you called it, homework for our discussion, you sent me a link to a project called the Dragon Project Trust.
Yeah.
And your description of it was the wild and woolly-ish. And so I wonder if you can let us know a little bit about
the idea behind the Dragon Project, which was started in the late 70s and became a trust in the 1980s, and still kicking around in different forms. First of all, we had all this stuff about energy, so we said, okay, well, let's take measurable energies, see what's there at some of these stone circles and other sites and the Great Pyramid and so on. And I didn't know, and don't think anybody else did, but we found out that quite a few of them are radioactive in a low level. The King's Chamber, for example, it's a granite. The granite is radioactive, and when you've got an enclosed space with it, it builds up whatever the radio radiation is. So we found that out, things like that, and then we found real anomalies like curious ultrasounds at certain times of the day in various stone circles. We found stones that had magnetic currents rushing through them for about an hour and a half. We never figured out why that was.
Wow.
And so on. So we looked at a range of things. But we also brought in dowsers, and we brought in psychics, people who can pick up things at sites, apparently. But we gave them all the same standard material. Like the dowsers were given site plans at Rollwright Stones near Oxford, and it's a Neolithic or early Bronze Age stone circle. And we said, okay, let's dowse any patterns you're picking up at ground level, 10 feet down, 20 feet, so three different levels. And they didn't, there was only one or two really master dowsers that got anything that was coherent. We also then had the psychics in separately at different times, and there was nothing.
Wow.
Nothing that matched. They had ideas of beams of light coming down and people in white robes and so on, you know, all this stuff, and psychometry.
Yeah.
And it just didn't. Didn't happen, but we tested it. We said, "Well, let's have a look."
Yeah,
and there's more work to be done there on that, really. But we gave up on that at the end. We don't really do the physical monitoring, although there might be a new project shortly to start with much superior equipment and so on, where we might test the physiological reactions of people of various places and so forth. But that's still. Nascent. That's still not as an embryonic project.
If you need any,
Then we thought we'd do dream work. You know, the idea of ancient temple sleep in ancient Greece and other cultures.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that. So go ahead.
And that's where Krittner came in as our consultant.
And if you could tell us just a bit about that before I have, you know, just another question for you before we close up. But I was going to ask you about the dream work a little bit.
Yeah. Well. Okay. In fact, I'm writing. We wrote a book on the Dragon Project years ago, decades ago, to be honest, called The Places of Power. And I'm actually in the process of rewriting it now in the light of a lot of new information. And that book, the new one, will have stuff on the Dream Project in it. Although you can get a summary on the Dragon Project website.
Website.
And the idea was we selected four locations, one a sacred mountain top in Wales, the other three prehistoric sites in Cornwall, and we asked volunteers across age ranges, across cultural backgrounds, across everything we could think of as mixed up as possible, and we asked them to come and sleep at these places, and they'd come. And we'd lay out a camp bed, and they have a sleeping bag, and they go to sleep inside these things, and we have people alongside helpers who would wake them. There'd be like a red light on, and they'd wake them when their rapid eye movement started in denoting dreaming sleep. Wake them up and tape record their whatever the dreams were, and then they go back to sleep. And we got a lot of stuff that way. Certain things that we wanted to do for statistical purposes didn't work out very well because people didn't give control dreams. But really what I personally wanted to do was to see if these dreams at different places by different people, but at the same place, lots of dreams by different people at each of these places, if there would be motifs in the dreams that would excite specific, if certain imagery would come up through the sleeping minds of these volunteers in each of the places. Now, the trouble was, for us, is that all these records were typed up, transcribed from the tape recordings. You know, we've got a few volumes of this stuff. But what we've had to do subsequently is digitize the whole lot.
Oh, wow.
And they are digitized now. And what that should be able to do when I've organized the material is to be able to make computer searches for motifs through each of the site materials. So it's quite a big job, and I'm leaving that to the end of this new book, but it'll be in there.
That is fantastic. You know, I was going to tell you before we ask our final question here that if you need some help in the work to understand the function of some of these ancient sites, you know, our next Secretary of Education, Ben Carson, I don't know if you're familiar with the individual. Do you know Ben Carson? The neurologist, the presidential candidate, the conservative, who says wonderful things like, I came from God, I didn't come from a monkey. Ben Carson has said Ben Carson has said on regular occasions that the Egyptian pyramids were constructed by the biblical character Joseph in order to store grain. And so he might be able to help you out on that work.
Well, that's very thoughtful. Really, field work's done on this now. It's just a question of physically sorting it through.
So I'm absolutely kidding, by the way. I just needed to get that Ben Carson reference in there. So lastly, I mean, I want to ask you about Time and Mind Journal. How did that come about? And, you know, because of all the things
Well, what had happened was when I quit the Lay Hunter Journal after 20 years, and realized that it was very difficult to bring research material into it.
Mm-hmm.
There was a lapse of time, and I talked with a colleague, Neil Mortimer, and we both agreed that what we need is something, as if you like, grown-up Earth Mysteries that was peer-reviewed as proper research, people who had read up on it, who had a background and could make coherent proposals and ideas and do specific research on a broad front, anthropological, archaeological, and so forth, historical, and so on, folklore, or the whole thing, a broad spectrum, but scholarly work. And we had to hang around. We tried to get a few magazines interested, and they didn't want to know. And then we tried a few academic journals, and that didn't quite happen until we ran into a company called Berg. And one of the women there said, this is interesting. There is a missing gap in the literature that is reliably scholarly, but is open and not just an ivory tower publication.
Yeah.
So that's what we tried to do. And it took 4 years getting international peer review ourselves of the proposal. And some people, this is rubbish, we're not going to do this. In the end, there was enough young professors and so on who said, yeah, we need this. We need this this gap filled in the literature, in the scholarly literature. So after 4 years, we finally got published by Berg. And then after several years, we got published briefly by Bloomberg. But now we're in with Routledge. Particularly academic publisher. And in fact, next year, 2017, marked by our special archaeoacoustic special issue, is our 10th year of publication.
Wow, congratulations.
And it's hard going because, as you know, even good stuff doesn't get through.
Yeah, that was going to be my comment, yes.
And of course, there's a limit to the space we have. What really did is, to be honest with you, when Routledge took us on, we were doing 3 issues a year, which was quite... You've got to get paid for this, you understand.
Yeah.
We could fit that in quite nicely, but Routledge said, no, we want 4 issues a year. And that extra issue is a killer.
That's huge.
More than I should be on this thing. But anyway, so far we've been going on, and we've got some tremendous papers have been published by anthropologists, archaeologists, as I say, folklorists, historians, and so on, all pushing the envelope a bit, but still with scholarly rigor, which to me is really important because life is too short to waste on empty speculation in these fields.
Oh boy!
So we're doing well, and that's one of my proudest achievements. Neil fell away after several years and is now a consultant, but I'm still the managing editor, and we have a team of excellent editor colleagues who process it, and then the big papers have to go out for external peer review as well.
I think it's one of your greatest accomplishments.
It's important. And it goes out to a lot of universities and institutions around the world, but I'm always keen for anybody who's in an institution, I say, make sure they take this journal, because it opens up a vast area of new research and new leads and new direction, and it's reliable material.
What I love about it, and I think you should be, it's one of your proudest achievements as well. I mean, what I love about the journal is this intersectional, interdisciplinary approach, this openness to step away from the sort of dead orthodoxy of the academy, but at the same time, not spinning us, as you say, into this kind of unsubstantiated and kind of mindless speculation. Everything is rooted in a kind of academic rigor that still makes it accessible for the academic community.
Thank you. That's exactly what we want it to be.
And the university has, by nature of the need for specialization, stepped away from creating contexts for interdisciplinary approaches to some of these things. And I think, especially in the field you're in, these fields, I mean, there's such layover between mythological studies and depth psychology and archaeology and anthropology that it's just necessary for us to sort of, bring experts from multiple fields in order to tackle some of these questions together.
Yeah.
I wanted to say lastly, another Joseph Campbell quote, he talks about the object becoming aesthetically significant when it becomes metaphysically significant. He says, if we are insightful when studying an artifact, it will become an oracle bespeaking the inner workings of humankind, and we become, as it were, archaeologists of the soul, explorers of that culture's mythologies and the symbolic consciousness of our species. And so I guess, lastly, your early life, your other incarnation as an artist, I see that as so profoundly important to where you went. I mean, I know in your bio you talk about kind of stepping away from your life as an artist, but I really feel that artistic eye is something that has stayed with you in your academic work and your research.
I totally agree, actually. I've said to a number of archaeologists, what you guys need is an artistic sensibility.
Hmm.
There's something about the artistic sensibility that is pattern making.
Hmm.
Making patterns, connecting, is really a very essential to any artist, particularly to somebody like a painter or a sound artist. It's connectivity of a neurological kind, if you like. And to come to archaeological or anthropological data with that mindset can lead to some unexpected cross-disciplinary possibilities. So yes, I'm still very pleased with having the artistic. I still paint occasionally when I can get around to it, when Routledge let me.
Yeah.
so it's still there, and I do think it's important as a pattern-making capacity.
Well, Paul,
not to be too dug into one particular ivory tower. It's really important to cross-reference, cross-discipline, and thinking outside a particular box, but without losing your center of gravity, if I can put it that way.
Well, I think, Paul, I mean, for two things. Thank you so much for taking the time to speak with us today. This has been illuminating and just fascinating. We so appreciate it.
Oh, you're very welcome. Thank you.
And the other thing I'd like to say, we're gonna have all of this information in terms of links to Time and Mind and to your sites and to all of the other work you have going on and all of the books. We'll have all of that on our website for folks to check out, links to all of it.
Right.
And, I just also want to thank you for being the sort of luminous presence that you are in this time that we talked about, to bring it back around to the beginning of the conversation. As our two countries are sort of stepping into this, I almost want to say unprecedented, but unfortunately it's quite precedented territory. And as you said, a reading of recent history shows us where this all leads. I think folks like you that can remind us of some of the larger capacities of our human nature and our connectivity to the land and to one another. I think that stuff is more important now than ever. And so it makes it more tragic when you talk about the loss of funding in that area, because I think more than ever, we need to be reminded of how to be human. And I think the work that you do speaks to that on so many levels. So I do thank you for that.
Thank you.
As a citizen of the world, I think we need that work now more than ever. Do you have anything you want to say as we're closing? either what's coming up next or anything
we didn't... I think I've said quite an offending. I've shut my mouth up sufficiently for the time being.
I'll have to have you...
There are other stuff I could say, and perhaps one day we'll have another conversation.
I would love that, and at that time you're going to have to lead off with this mysterious story about what happened to you and your wife at the crossroads in Ireland.
Yes. Oh, yes,
I will. I'm anticipating that. Well, Paul, thank you so much. Have
it's
a good
so
rest
weird.
Of the
day. It's so weird. I don't say it too soon, too often. You value everything else, but it happened.
Oh, boy.
Okay, Andy, thank you very, very much. I enjoyed it thoroughly.
Thank you, Paul. Have a good rest of your day.
Thank you.
You've been listening to Take On care. The Block Bye-bye. Radio. Bye-bye. Our guest has been Paul Devereux, folks. You're listening to On the Block Radio. This is your host, Andy Gervich. And we will see you on the other side.
Thank you for listening to On the Block. We talk to smart people so you don't have to. We'll be back in a moment.
Now, what is that, Paul? What are we hearing?
Well, that's a huge piece of igneous rock on Carn Menyn in the Preseli Hills being struck with a very small hammer stone.
And it's quite a pleasant sound, isn't it?
Well, it's not the sound you expect of rock on rock, no. It's called a ringing rock, and there are a large number of them up on Carn Menyn, which is the source area of at least some of the bluestones that are now standing in Stonehenge.
So you tested the bluestones in Wales, and they are what you would call ringing rocks.
Yes,
musical rocks.
A high percentage are, yes.
Right, and Stonehenge is as well, made up of the same sort of rocks?
Some of the bluestones, yes, have been identified as coming from the outcrops of rock at Carn Menyn and other outcrops in the same area of the Preseli Hills.
Is it possible, then, that in ancient times, they were used in a musical way, that they were sounded?
Well, we don't know exactly what happened in Neolithic Britain, but we do know that such rocks were deemed very important in other parts of the ancient world. In China, for example, resonant rocks were called Beiyinshi, and they even wrote poems about them, and they thought that such rocks had high concentrations of supernatural power, of chi. In India, ringing rocks were embedded in temples. I could give you the whole range of basic notes of Indian classical music from a single rock. And in America, the Native Americans use them. I've tested some there myself in their vision quest sites and so on. So this is not an isolated thing. A lot of people in the ancient world thought the spirits or powers existed inside rocks, and we just thought, well, maybe the Neolithic people who built Stonehenge also thought these rocks had special power or mana or whatever, and might be one of the reasons they took them all the way to Stonehenge on Salisbury Plain.
Upon thousands of prehistoric sites around Britain, and if you just count stone circles, nothing else, just stone circles, there's nearly 1,000 of them. It's incredible that out of all those sites, most people only seem to know this one.
Now, obviously, I'm not being dismissive of Stonehenge itself. Just the fact that when visitors come to marvel at the imposing monoliths, they miss the scale and significance of the entire complex. There are literally hundreds of prehistoric sites spreading for miles in all directions. earthworks, long barrows, avenues of stones, burial sites, and the massive cursus, they all show that this was a huge, thriving community. Woodhenge, a couple of miles northeast, is the remains of a complex timber structure, probably an enclosed circular building which sat on its own raised mound, long since flattened by ploughing. West Kennet Long Barrow to the north, at 350 feet long, is the largest chambered tomb in England and Wales. And a little further north again is Silbury Hill, the biggest man-made mound in Europe. It's estimated that to build this giant would have taken 500 men working every day for 10 years. The term henge originally came from Stonehenge. In Old English, it refers to the hanging stones or lintels, but it came to mean something quite different. And ironically, Stonehenge itself is not, strictly speaking, a henge. Henges have a ditch inside the raised bank, but at Stonehenge, the ditch lies on the outside, which implies that they had quite different functions. The true henge of this vast Wiltshire complex is Avebury. Avebury is over 20 miles north of Stonehenge, a short day's walk for our ancestors, and it is without doubt the grandest ceremonial site in Britain. Today its splendour is really only visible from the air, but when it was built it must have been a breathtaking sight. When Avebury was excavated in the early part of the 20th century, the surrounding ditch was found to have been sheer-sided and 30 feet deep. On the outside of the ditch was a wide, flat terrace running at the foot of the bank, which towered 20 feet above the central earthwork. Our ancestors excavated 150,000 tons of chalk rubble to create the ditch, an immense undertaking for something clearly of immense importance. And it wasn't the only one in the region. 50 miles to the west in Somerset stands the deceptive stone circle of Stanton Drew.
It looks pretty boring, doesn't it? An enormous stone circle with a smaller outer one at each end. But its bland appearance on the landscape gives no clue as to its original scale and importance. This circle is over 100 metres across. Now, in diameter, that makes it second only to the vastness of Avebury. Some years ago, the Ancient Monuments Laboratory of English Heritage carried out a magnetometer survey across the whole site, and what they discovered is breathtaking. Inside the circle were 9 concentric rings of wooden posts, each post a metre apart, and each post a metre or more across. Now, you don't use a post a metre or more across unless you need it to be tall. And on top of that, the whole site was surrounded by a ditch and a raised bank. It may have been wood, but this would have been every bit as impressive as the stone circles of Stonehenge and Avebury.
But perhaps there is a reason for the posts not to have been so tall. The design of a henge implies that the banks were for spectators. The inner terrace at Avebury adds weight to this idea, suggesting a level walkway for finding your place before climbing the bank, exactly as we still do at arenas today. There would be no sense in having posts so tall that they obscured the spectator's view, and they need only be the height of a man for the audience to see the whole spectacle from their raised position on the massive bank. So why create an artificial forest where spectators could see, but participants could not? For me, the most likely answer is blood sports. And shocking as that may sound to many, it's important to remember that this was a time when most of Britain was covered in forest, and the most skilled hunter would probably have been held in high esteem, possibly even beyond his own community. The deep ditch would stop animals escaping into the crowd, while the forest of posts would create an enclosed, but nevertheless real, hunting ground. And then again, this amount of huge posts could easily have supported a floor, exactly the same design concept as at the Great Colosseum of Rome, but preceding it by thousands of years. we can only wonder.
You've been listening to On the Block Radio with Andrew Gurevich. The show is produced in Portland, Oregon by Michael DiNapoli at MD Productions. Theme music by Moving the Mountain. Closing music by Jonathan Oak. Look us up on the web at ontheblockradio.com. You can also find us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Don't forget to tune in next week for a brand new episode. Previous episodes can be found on our website. Thanks for listening.
Oh, you're beautiful, kitty kitties. Oh, look at you out there. Beauty like a bolt, light in a darkened hallway. New minds looking at this world, at our lives, through the perspective of apocalypse children. Standing dusty in the barren highways, standing broken before the fathers who were meant to make us whole, but who only lied to us about what it meant to be a man, about what it meant to be a woman, about what it meant to be a child of this doomed age.